Welcome back, geology fans. It was a short walk from the Lyons Sandstone at Stop 2A to get to Stop 2B, the Lykins Formation. We start, as always, looking at the big picture. The red color indicates the iron in the rock was oxidized at deposition, and the iron has to have some land source, as oceans don't supply iron very well. So we should be either subaerial or in oxygenated water near a landmass. Standing back, we see very thin layers, which we have not seen before. These thin layers form a series of arched domal structures. These look like the classic sedimentary form made by the single-celled, colonial, photosynthesizing bacteria called stromatolites. I mentioned stromatolites before as having been the dominant form of fossil at the time of the Idaho Springs, 1.7 billion years ago. However, stromatolites crashed when multicellular animals evolved to eat them up, so we will reserve judgment as we approach the outcrop to get the details. The thin layers feel sandy to the touch, and it is another sandstone unit standing up in a ridge, but it is much finer grained sand than we saw before, and even finer grained sand than the windblown sands of the Lyon Formation, indicating an even lower energy of the environment than wind. All our previous formations showed no reaction with hydrochloric acid, and we might not expect it here either, but to our surprise, we get effervescence. This is a sandstone cemented with hematite and calcite. The Lykins varies in location from the calcite-rich sandstone that we see here to a sandy limestone elsewhere. This suggests the Lykins was formed underwater. There are ripples found at this site, and with the ferric iron present, we are getting convinced of a shallow water environment. To get the sand along with the calcite, there would have to be a protected bay that gets very little sand input over time. Looking back to the thinly layered domal forms, our interpretation of stromatolites is consistent with this idea of a shallow, protected bay. But why are stromatolites here when they crashed a few hundred million years before? There are a few places where stromatolites remain alive today, and the most famous is Shark Bay, Australia. This is a protected, shallow bay, as we might envision the Lykins Formation was. The reason the stromatolites can live there is because the evaporation rate is high enough to cause the water to be hypersaline. The hypersalinity prohibits the animals that would eat the stromatolites otherwise. The Lykins Formation shows signs of what we call chicken wire structure, indicative of gypsum evaporite deposits that were deposited at the same time and later dissolved away. In other locations, Lykins shows algal mat structures and salt hoppers, which are square to cubic impressions left by dissolved salt crystals in the formation. All the pieces of the puzzle fit together. The evidence is converging. The Lykins Formation is a shallow, protected, and hypersaline bay with stromatolites and evaporites. Before, we were at the beach. Now, we're underwater. The ash beds contained tell us this outcrop is at the bottom of the Lykins with an age of about 260 million years old. The top of the Lykins is on the other side of the outcrop and it dates more around 240 million years ago. The Permian is the last period of the Paleozoic and ends at 251 million years ago with the largest mass extinction we see in the rock record. Best estimates are that 97% of all species in the oceans went extinct and 70% of all species on land. And in fact, this is the only extinction to ever hit the insects. And those buggers are tough. So this is why some call this the day the Earth nearly died. The dating on this means the Lykins does not stop depositing until after this extinction event takes place. We can think of the west side of the valley on the other side of this ridge as being the Valley of Death. Now, many ideas have been proposed as to how this extinction may have been caused. Asteroid impact, or gamma ray burst that strips our ozone layer, or Pangaea fully forming and basically limiting the coastal environments anymore, and then actually starting to break apart again and expose our organic-rich flanks to the air. That would consume oxygen and cause problems that way. Or how about giant volcanic eruptions in Siberia, which in the end is one of the most compelling smoking guns for this mystery. Back in 2011, a report was published of an examination of an ancient bog in Canada that was depositing at this time. The detailed and well-preserved layers of that ancient bog show three distinct layers of fly ash coming up to the extinction event. Now, fly ash is what you get when you burn coal, and we require that fly ash be stored in secure, toxic landfills because of its nasty environmental consequences. The high alkalinity and heavy metal concentrations are among its worst traits. The eruptions going on in Kamchatka and Siberia were no minor affair either. We call them traps, which is a term for monstrously prodigious quantities of basaltic lava pouring onto the surface, far beyond any volcanic area today. These flood basalts were coming up through country rock that contained the recently deposited Carboniferous, which most of our coal comes from. So when the magma hit the coal, it must have erupted as a giant cloud of fly ash that could be ejected high enough into the atmosphere to burn around the world and end up in this ancient bog in Canada. And before you think it's a short trip from Russia to Canada, remember this was Pangaea, and the trip was a bit more like clear around the globe. So this ash didn't just fall in a Canadian bog, it fell into the ocean and across the supercontinental landscape. Heavy metals biomagnifying up food chains and ocean water becoming acidic from all the carbon emitted from the volcanoes and burning coal just hammer the marine species and has a marked effect on our ancestors on land. You know, up to this point, the rock record shows those mammal-like therapsid ancestors were outcompeting the dinosaur-like saurapsid reptiles, but the Canadian bog shows what turned the tables. One eruption of fly ash is bad enough, but a second rain of toxic material from the sky, and then a third, was too much for many forms of life. The mammal-like reptiles took it harder than the dinosaur-like reptiles, and so even though our line made it through this global nightmare as some form of pelicosaur, probably, the dinosaur line will become dominant directly west of where we are standing. At this location, you are standing in the Paleozoic and look east at the Mesozoic, aka the Age of Reptiles. So for our chart, this is 2B, the Lykins Formation, whose age is 260 million years. It is a sandstone whose minerals are quartz grains with calcite, hematite, salt, and gypsum cements. Grain size is all under 1 millimeter. The thin layers speak of stromatolites, which indicate a shallow, protected, hypersaline bay. And the event being recorded is the final wearing down of the ancestral Rocky Mountains and continued transgression of sea level.